You want to hear it?
Yeah, go ahead. Woo! Shake it, Jen. Come on. All right, it is the Yeah Come On Show, show 164. I'm Southside Steve, your host. My co-host is running all the board and all the stuff. That is one Evan Brando. Say hello, Evan.
Howdy, howdy.
Brett Barney, well, he's in the bathroom. So there you go. That's where our co-host is. I sent him there. And I told him not to do one thing, but do the normal thing. If that makes any sense.
I don't know. I don't want to know what that is.
You don't want to know.
I got there, but I'm not happy I connected those dots.
Here's what Jen, he's not doing a one or a two. He's doing a three. And I'll let you live with that. I don't know what but I know what a three is.
What's a three? Like a cha-cha-cha? Like he had bad Mexican?
Yes. Well done. He has the diarrhea. So I'm like, stay in there. I'm going to talk to Jen. I can't have you in here anyway. Jen Hobby, sitting next to me, is a broadcaster in Atlanta. She has been in the business for a long time. She has worked for stations like 95.5 The Beat.
That's right.
That's where it all started.
That's where it started, the Biot.
Biot.
Rest in peace.
I know.
Girl got rhythm. Then she went to Q100. They got the beat, too. Dancing. You can dance. I know you can dance, can't you? Do you dance in between songs to y'all's music? Do y'all come?
Sure, yeah.
All right, because we play air guitar on the rock side.
Okay.
Just letting you know what goes on, you know, when the song's playing.
I can air drum, too.
That's good.
I just do air bass.
Okay.
Just the one I pluck.
Just like the, yeah.
air tambourine. Somebody's got to do it. And then you went to Middays on 101.5 New Country.
Yep, just down the hall from you.
Yeah, and I used to pop in because I was doing morning, so I would get off air, and then I would come torture Jen and talk to her.
It was still Kix back then, though.
It was Kix.
Yeah.
Oh, God, Kix. All these name changes. That's the problem with you. You got to stick with something. Stay with it. And then there's Star 94. Now, that used to be, what was that before? It was QXI. It was, what did they call Star 94 before Star? 94Q. It was 94Q.
Yes.
That's
and
what
then
it was.
But it's been Star 94 forever.
Yeah, and that's where you are.
Heritage Station in Atlanta. Yeah, that's where I've been since 2016.
2016. So what year did you start getting paid in radio?
Oh, that's a good question. Oh, God. This is going to date me, though.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't want anybody doing the math on how old I am, because at this point, I just say I'm 40-something. But I think my first paid gig in radio was at 95.5 The Beat, and it was early 2000s. I want to say 2001, maybe?
That's all you got? That's your dating?
2001? Yeah.
Wow. I can date worse than that. How about college radio? And I was supposed to graduate college in 1987, the year my wife was born. Hi, honey. Love you. That'd have been fantastic. Can you see me in a cap and gown? And I wanted to go where you went. I went to Georgia State. And all of a sudden, somebody puts a baby in my arms, go, one day this will be your wife. I'm like, really? I mean, there's an age gap.
There's a little bit of an age gap, but you waited, and it was worth the wait.
Thank you.
It was worth the wait. Amanda is an awesome rock star wife, and she's just...
She's opposite of me. She's a good person.
Superstar. A superstar to put up with you.
I know. Jen, you had an opportunity.
I don't know how she does it.
You had an opportunity. I mean, I dated other people in your room, but not you. Jen never did. Jen.
No, I was by the time we became friends, I was already dating my husband.
I know. And we'll get into that. Grant, if you're watching or listening, Grant is a dark-complected Ken doll. That's what I call you behind your back. That's a compliment, by the way.
He is.
He's a little Ken doll.
He's hot. Yeah.
He's hot.
That's why I locked it in.
I mean,
kidding me?
Me too. I locked in for the same reason.
I'm marrying up and he wants to date me. Okay, let's lock it in. Let's go. Let's make this official, legal, and all the things.
Yeah. Why date when we can marry?
Yeah. You're hot. In front of God, that's binding.
We did get married pretty fast too.
Mm-hmm.
Weren't you and Amanda pretty quick too?
Yeah, what we did is we started dating. And I remember she was 24 to my 47, somewhere in there. And we had her birthday, and then we dated exactly a year. And we started going out March 10th. I asked her to marry me the following year on March 16th on my birthday.
That's cool.
So what I did is something that's always about me, and I make my birthdays about me, I made it about her. And that was kind of what I thought was kind of a cool move.
And a year is pretty quick.
Yeah, and a year is pretty quick, but I did the four seasons. I didn't have a lot of time to play around because I knew she wanted children. And I'm like, oh, God. So I start going, well, we got to like travel the country and you got to wear like, you know, shoestrings for bathing suits and we got to have sex all over the place and we got to travel before we have kids.
And then you had kids.
And then we had kids. After 3 years, we're like, I even announced it. It was like New Year's, and we were all at the beach, and I just went, we're having sex, and I'm staying in. Just letting everybody know. I'd never done that. Never. I did not
but
realize.
But you were married at that point. I mean, you weren't going to get married to not have a family with her.
That's the only reason I got married. Yeah. Everybody told me don't get married unless. Marriage is tough. It is the hardest thing.
Yeah,
in
nobody
the world.
Tells you that. It's all fairy tales and romance, and especially for women, we get sold this, you know, idea of what marriage is going to be like, and then it is a lot of hard work. But that's why you got to pick the right person to duke it out with, to you know, be your person who's got your back no matter what, and you've got theirs, and you got to ride through all kinds of stuff in life together. And
I know.
They better be your friend.
They better be,
so
yes.
I'm glad you guys had the 3 years where you, you know, traveled the country in a G-string. Was it your G-string or her G-string?
Both. Okay. I would have won, too. I mean, okay. It looks great. It looks fantastic. It's a little wider, but I'm no stranger to a nude beach. I've done it.
Okay. You know? I don't know why, but I can see you in that thing, that Borat.
Borat thing.
Suit.
Yeah, that's what I was picturing too.
Yeah. I can picture the Borat suit.
Yeah.
You know, the one didn't John Mayer wear it on a cruise one time?
He did.
Like, that'd be funny or whatever. I can see you like rocking that and taking yourself very seriously, walking down the beach.
And I'd walk up and have conversations, and then you know when nobody knows, because you know I'm not a shower as much as I definitely am a grower. So I would just be tapping myself with the cup just to kind of keep things going.
Make sure.
So everybody will be like, "Why? Just make sure, you know, warm weather."
Like, I can picture you with your hot wife in a matching one walking down the beach. No. And like she would look all smoking hot and you'd be hot. You'd just be like that hot couple.
Hot couple.
Like, wow, that couple's like really feeling themselves today. Like, okay.
What's up? Can you imagine what we do in our rooms? Can you?
Can you?
Can you? Can you?
Yeah, actually, those bathing suits don't leave that much to the imagination. So,
Yeah.
They don't. So now we're both married and we have children. I have a 2 and a 5 that are within the month and a half are going to become a 3 and a 6.
Oh, that is a sweet age. Tough age for, you know, they're going through stuff, especially the 3-year-old. But such a sweet time, and it's so fleeting. You just have to enjoy it.
I'm soaking it up. Thanks to pandemic and unemployment, I've been home a lot, so it works.
You know what? God works in crazy ways.
He does, and I believe you.
So,
can I talk to God for a second?
Yeah.
Please tell me. Give me an idea of what's happening next. I got to know.
Dear Jesus.
Talk to me.
Dear Jesus, I know it's all in your timing. But Lord, could you give me a hint?
What's up, God?
Lord, let's just hold. Lord have mercy. I'm here with Jim. Talk to me. No, and I want to say how much, you know, and I'll bring it up quickly, but just, you know, you see things and you worry. Anything happens to a child, I get emotional. You know, it's the heart. I mean, I've done my things at Choa. I've done, you know, where you're there and it's like the kid and he hugs me and she goes, he never hugs anybody. I'm like, okay, I got tears.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm not even the crier type. I watched Top Gun and didn't cry, the new one. And everybody said I was going to and I didn't. But your daughter, I just want to say God bless. And I know you and Grant,
thank
your husband,
you.
Went through something there. Your two little sweet, pretty daughters. And boy, they're your kids. You know, they got mama's looks. But what she went through with cancer, I'm just so glad.
Oh, yes.
Can't
we are
imagine.
Too. We are too. I mean, it's the grace of God and the miracle of medicine. And
100%.
We're so grateful for her oncologist and the whole team at Children's Healthcare of Atlanta. They're amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Reese had a germ cell tumor at the base of her spine when she was just 10 months old.
Lord have mercy.
And so, went through chemotherapy and lived it at the Eggleston campus at Children's for a long time. And but we came through on the other side with such a changed perspective on what's important in life.
Oh, yeah.
Just a changed perspective on so many things. And, you know, Grant and I said, how do you say thank you to the people who saved your child's life? And the answer to that is you fundraise for what's important to them. So we've been fundraising for research to support her oncologist, Dr. Olson. And he's an incredible guy and does all kinds of amazing work around the world sharing information about children with cancer so that oncologists in Japan and oncologists in Australia and in Great Britain can all share their information and save more kids just like Reese. So,
which is fantastic.
Yeah. So we feel so blessed about that and really feel like very lucky to come on the other side of it.
I just want you to know that currently I'm unemployed, so I can't give any money right now, so don't ask. I mean, I know you're probably fundraising, don't ask me, but I do give $22 a month. Is it $22 or $20 a month to Choa?
That's amazing.
I do that.
Well, I won't ask you to give me any money right now, but would you come and be a part of the event?
Hold on one second. Damn. Yes, of course I would. I'm making a joke. Of course I would. I would do that. You
caught him on camera. He can't say no on camera.
No, no. That's why I looked at the camera. I'm like, really? She just asked me that on camera?
Of course she did. She got you.
Is this working? Test it. 1, 2, 3.
See, you don't always have to give from your wallet. You can give your talents. So no. You could come to our event. You could be on the mic. You could entertain some people. You could host. You could be the auctioneer.
I would do that in a heartbeat.
You could wear the G-string thing.
I would.
And
for the kids.
We could auction you off.
Hi. I'm Southside Steve. This is Southside Steve Sr. How's everybody doing? I'm actually emceeing the Down and Derby here in Milton.
Awesome.
I'll be doing that. So I try to do charities right. I rode a Harley for 20 years, not because I wanted to wear leather and the lifestyle. I just love that particular motorcycle. I like loud. I like chrome. But I did most every day I rode it, it was for a charity.
Oh my gosh. You know? The bike community, yeah. The mm-hmm. Harley, I don't know if that's what it's called, but like the yeah. Harley community is so giving. Those people have the biggest hearts and are always doing something to give back. That's so cool.
So that's kind of, you know, one of the things I did. And then we talk about, you know, being married and doing this crazy thing called radio. And I started out, let's see, I did Georgia State 88.5. I went in as a 27-year-old freshman and went back to school.
That's a legendary launching pad for people.
It
88.5,
is. 100,000 watts. People don't realize you're like, and I'll put my two fingers up. You're listening to the 100,000 let me get the phrasing down.
You
it's
got
been
this.
A long time. I can do it.
You can dial. It's somewhere buried in your brain.
Mm-hmm. Welcome to the concrete campus of Georgia State University. You're listening to the 100,000 watt voice of WRAS album 88.
Yes, there it is.
Very nice.
Yeah, that was buried.
Still got it.
That was deep. Yeah. But that's what got me started. And then I wasn't even planning on getting into radio. What for me is I wanted to do stand-up. And I said, I'll get used to being on a microphone. I was working at the airlines. I knew a buddy that was going to state. He was doing the weather.
I didn't know that. That's so cool.
So I said, I'll just get used to it. And then all of a sudden, I'm literally in an ad agency right next to the Chrome Gouda building right there off Claremont where 96 Rock was. And there was like a little duck pond and our agency was there. And I had a bungee jump client and they're like, bought time. I go up to do the commercial and I hired two voices. Well, one of the voice guys didn't show. I did it. And the guy goes, you're great. Have you ever even thought about being in radio? I'm like, well, I'm on 88. Well, turn in your tapes. Next thing I know, I'm doing weekends on 96 Rock.
That's so
cool.
And
then never look back.
So cool.
So, and same with you. So you went to my life is Jen's life. I want Jen's life. First
really?
Off.
Really?
Because you went to Florida State. That's where I wanted to go.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I grew up in Florida, so it was in-state tuition for our family.
Okay.
And I come from a long line of Seminoles. So
oh, boy.
My mom and dad went to Florida State. My older cousin went to Florida State. My cousin Casey and my younger brother went to Florida State. So we have a big family, garnet and gold thing.
Well, do you want a drink?
That would.
Do you want to taste it? You haven't tasted my bourbon, have you?
I haven't tasted your bourbon.
See, now I got you. This is, by the way, my glass. You want to get?
He put me on the spot.
Yeah, that's
I put
right.
Him on the spot. Now he's putting me on the spot.
You can't say no on camera.
You just nailed me for a charity. I'm definitely getting you drunk. By the way, Grant, Amanda, we'll be home tonight around 9.
It's a beautiful day outside. We're taking this to a patio with margaritas later. Ooh. I'm kidding.
I'll let you have mine.
Oh, we can do it outside.
So okay. See, it's smooth.
Okay.
And it's smoky.
Ooh.
And it goes through a quantum purity, so it basically is a 2-year bourbon that drinks like a 5 or 7. All the impurities removed. We say that if you drink it straight, this and our vodka, you will not get a hangover.
Really?
Because all the junk's taken out. Everything that gives you those rosy bourbon cheeks or the headaches is all out.
We put that to the test pretty hard at the release party, and I gotta tell you, the science works.
I also need to know: does every guest get bourbon? Is this like an indoctrination into your podcast? Well, like, is everybody on the show in person have a sip?
No.
Yeah.
Or are you just trying to get me to spill the beans on some stuff?
That, maybe. I need you to loosen up,
Jen. I'm not loosened up.
No, you're loose. I give everybody bourbon. I don't withhold. The only person that doesn't drink bourbon on my show is Jess.
I thought I was being really open.
No, you are.
Okay. I'm really here. I'm
no
like,
secrets.
I'm like in
just
the
drink
moment.
The bourbon,
I'm feeling,
Jen.
Feeling very present. Okay, I'm gonna sip the bourbon. I'm not really a bourbon or a liquor drinker.
Oh,
I'm
no.
Like I'm like a wine person.
All right. Well, I don't have a wine yet.
Like I'm a mom who likes my wine and my Instagram. Give Those me are one my little, escapes.
I'll tell you what. You have one little sip, and I'll finish yours.
Okay.
There we go.
It does smell smoky.
You know, the smoky aftertaste is what I wanted. I wanted smooth and smoky.
Didn't it just win an award?
It did. It got the silver medal in London.
Look how he teed you up for that.
Thank you for that one.
Good producer.
Yeah. That was really nice. Yeah, so, that was like a
silver medal is 90.
Bump set spike right there.
Bam, 90 to 94. Okay. I got I think a 93 in London. All right.
That is very smooth.
Way smooth. You can talk right
after
you drink.
That is so nice. There was no bite. But I was waiting for the burn at the back.
You want to keep it now, don't you?
It's really good. Yeah, you're not having this. You can pour
it. I need another cup. I need a cup. Right now, proud sponsor. That's right. Legends. Yet Come On Bourbon Whiskey. Proud sponsor of the Yet Come On Show. Again, our guest, Jen Hobby. Jen Hobby of Star 94. One question, you know, when you go back, I want an immediate answer.
Okay.
Here, if you can do this. I just wrote this out, and I don't do show prep. But I have to. I'm kind of guy that shoots from the hip. You're a show prepper. You're a host.
Yeah, it was actually weird coming to see you today for an interview that I'm not prepping for.
Yeah.
It's weird.
You don't have to prep. You just got to be you.
I'm always the interviewer, never the interviewee. So it was very strange today.
All right. Best interview.
Oh, this is good.
I think I know who it should be because I think I know who we both interviewed. But you did it as a group. I did it one-on-one.
Are you going to say Lionel Richie?
John Travolta.
Oh, John Travolta is on my list. He's always on my list.
JT, baby.
So good.
He told me I could call him JT. I was like...
I know. He has one of the magical talent to make each person he talks to feel like the only person in the room.
He sat with me for 50 minutes, and then I'd been in a car accident. That when I almost died off of Spring Street when I totaled out the 96 Rock truck and hit a post, and the light came down and through the windshield. It was nasty.
Crazy.
And he wrote it out, and then when he's flying, you know, he said, well, here's the deal. You had the experience. Then this happens, and that happened. And I was like, okay, this is Scientology, but I don't care. And he was walking me through it, how you relive the moment, and it heals you. It heals your mind, which heals your body. So I was like, all right, you can tell me whatever you want. But and then the person came. He goes, I'm okay. I'm with Steve. We're okay. And waved him off. Just me and my producer.
I love that.
And the guy called me in his airplane taking off out of Atlanta in a 707 just to check on me. And he said, I've got a doctor for you. Go to this doctor. I went. Then he called me 3 weeks later on my cell phone to ask if I went and how it went. And then I showed up. He came into town, and I called him because I knew he was in town. He goes, where are you at? I thought I was going to see you. And I said, no, and it was Star 94 had the interview. I didn't.
Amazing, and though. What
so
a cool guy.
Just
it's
cool.
Like one of those people that somebody recently told me, be where your feet are, which is just another way of saying be present, right?
In that moment.
It was a sports agent. Her name's Molly Fletcher. She was the sports agent for John Smoltz for...
Love Smoltz.
So she's like the female Jerry Maguire. You got to follow her, okay?
She's so cool. All right.
She was a big sports agent for a long time, and now she does like public speaking, and that was one of the things she said. She said, be where your feet are. She said, coaches tell their athletes that all the time, be where your feet are. And that's exactly what you're talking about with John Travolta. He is exactly where his feet are and can connect in those moments. And now you're still talking about it, however many... years later.
It was his 50th birthday. I don't know how old he is now. Yeah.
So cool.
So I want to ask you, out of all your moments, because you've had some big guests on different shows, is there anybody that just strikes you that's your number one?
Gosh, that's hard to say. There are so many for so many different reasons. I will say John Travolta was one of them. He looked at me. He's like, you look like my friend Jenna Elfman. And I was like, I will never forget that. So he's definitely on the list because he was so present and there. And I'll never forget that because it was for that movie he did with Joaquin Phoenix, too.
Oh, yes.
So this is a funny story. So we had a group interview, and it was when I was working on the Burt Show at Q100. And we were all in a room, and they would just bring the celebrity into the room, and you'd do the interview.
And everybody's firing.
Right, and everybody's kind of firing off. But... Joaquin Phoenix kept walking by the room, and he would like look at me, and I would look at him like, is he coming in here next? Like thinking he's coming in for the next interview.
He was checking you out.
And then he would just walk by.
Oh.
And then you know how Joaquin's kind of like an odd dude?
He's way
weird,
odd.
Very famously a weird fella.
Right?
No,
and he would just kept walking by and checking it out and walking by. So that's part of why I remember that interview, because everybody else on the show was like, I think he keeps coming in here checking you out, but he's not going to come in for an interview.
You're like, am I dreaming this, or like, is Joaquin Phoenix here?
Is this really, is that the eighth time he's walked by? I think it is. I think so.
Oh my God.
Anyway, that's
hilarious.
A memorable moment right there. Let's see. Some of the others. I love interviewing Kelly Clarkson because mm-hmm. she's super chill and down to earth. She's exactly who you hope she is and want her to be. And we really connected in a couple of different interviews.
We grabbed her off of you guys once.
Yeah.
It was at Q100 and she was coming down the hall and we grabbed her. I pulled her in.
Yeah.
It was me.
I've had her at Star and at Q and at a bunch of different places. And then we connected actually over the pandemic. She was putting out an album and doing some music for Trolls, that movie, the Trolls movie.
Yeah, I love Trolls.
Kids movie. And so
I love it because of kids. I personally don't love it. I've enjoyed it because of my Trolls.
You're not a fan of the Trolls films.
No, but my kids are.
I am. I think it's great music.
You can own that one.
I mean, come on. Anna Kendrick, Justin Timberlake. Come on. It's not bad.
You're hot blonde. You can say it. It's little things with rainbows and stuff.
Yeah,
and
I'm like, okay. Okay. It'll be There's not good for your stuff. Image.
I like Incredibles. What's up?
Well, that's Brad Bird. It's his finest work, but I digress.
Okay.
So good.
Thank
so
you. That's
good.
Why he's in the room, because he knows those things.
Yeah, totally. That was a good reference.
Good
right
job,
there.
Evan.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So Kelly Clarkson is what we were saying.
Yeah.
So she did a bunch of Zoom interviews and just chatted with me over Zoom, and we did like an Instagram live together. So that was really cool.
She's real.
During that time, I also got to connect with Katy Perry, who's mm-hmm. awesome.
She is, too.
And, it was right before she was having her baby.
Never talked to Katy.
And she was really, really cool. Interviewed her a couple of different times, once in person with Q and mm-hmm. And once over the pandemic. So just so many different people. And what's cool about celebrities is that they're just human beings.
No, they are. 100%.
And they just have cool jobs. And they either, you know, the ones we interview are either in some movies and TV shows, which is cool.
Sports
interviews or, or obviously musicians and performers. They all have just cool jobs.
Didn't
to talk
you marry
to them about,
a musician?
Yes. And then also divorced a musician.
What band was that? Do you want to say?
I can. Are we diving way that back deep?
At least let her finish the bourbon.
Okay, we're going to go from small batch to large batch.
Large batch.
Welcome. If we're going there.
It's called Drinking with Gin.
Yes.
Hi, I'm your host, Southside Steve, and today we drink with gin and uncover naughtiness.
I was going to say.
I'm going to change the
are
logo.
We go, are
the
we
show.
Going down the divorce road? Or are we going
no,
down the
you've only
rock
had
and
one.
Roll
You've only
lifestyle?
Had one.
Just one.
That's good. There's other people that I don't know have had three and four. You're fine. It
and
was
you're
your
not going to have any.
No.
So that's good.
If I do, I'm done. No, I can't have
you're
one.
Not going to have any. See?
No. I just know he was in a band. I couldn't remember. I know it was a small band. He came in studio. You hit on him and y'all got married.
No, that is not the story.
Tale as old as time.
That is not the story.
I heard you were in studio and Melissa didn't want him, so you did.
No, that's how I met Grant. That's how I met my husband now.
Oh, same thing with my wife. So I'm just as guilty as you are. I met her. She was a client. In 2 years, we got together.
Yeah. So
same
I
thing.
Met
I'm
Grant.
Saying,
yeah. And, it's funny. I recently sent Bert a happy anniversary because he just celebrated his 20 years on Q100.
That is a long time on A station.
Huge.
That
and
is.
I was there for 10 of it. So he and I have stayed friendly. We've gone through our bumps through the years, but stayed friendly and recently sent him a card. And that helped us reconnect. And I was telling, and in the card, I thanked him. I was like, I can't thank you enough for saying yes to this teeny tiny little marching band in South Cobb High School.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I got to know Grant, because Bert saw a thing in the AJC that said, hey, South Cobb is the only marching band in the state of Georgia that can go march in the presidential inauguration. And it was President Obama's inauguration for, first time he was in office.
Which I know you were happy about
deal.
And I wasn't, but go ahead.
I know, we'll go down that road later. That's more bourbon. Bert said, hey, I think we can help this local marching band.
Sure.
And the rest of the show was like, really? It's Thanksgiving time. Like, who's going to give money to a marching band? We weren't really sure if we should get behind it.
Oh,
but
it's a great idea.
Bert was like, nope, this is what we're doing.
Good
we're
going to
help. We're going to help this little small marching band. They need equipment and they need all this stuff and, travel and everything else. And they couldn't afford it. So we started fundraising for them. And then a week later, their very hot principal walked in studio.
Oh, yes. Once again. And I always do this. If you're just tuning in, it's a TV show.
He's not a principal anymore. He's a superintendent, but he's still hot. And
he's way hot. Grant.
He locked it in. We've now been married for 12 years.
You little dark-complected kinder. I was there when you were dating her. Hotness. Hotness. No, but he married hot, too.
So you had the right story, just the wrong marriage.
Yeah, wrong marriage. I'm not going to get into that. I won't get into the
See,
rock
Steve,
star.
Steve, you should not show prep.
Yeah, I know.
You should just
I'm better
go.
If I don't show prep. This
don't
is stupid.
Show prep,
all right,
Steve.
Well, try this show prep. I wrote this out. I thought of it when I was sitting on the toilet. And by the way, I sit down to pee. It doesn't mean I'm doing dirty deeds. Everybody, by the way, should sit down to pee. Because
why do you sit down to pee?
Because it's first off, it's stealth. It's quiet. So I realized...
Because you are tall. There's a longer distance, which is going to make it louder.
So most people have their guest bedroom or guest bathrooms adjacent to like the living area. So when you're at a party or something, or if somebody's watching TV and you're a dude, you can hear the...
That is awkward. And then, but you can turn on the fan.
No, but still, you still hear it. And then you get to hear when there's a little bit left. And your fan, you try your fan. I can still go.
You Why do you sound like Donald Duck?
You
Duck
don't ever turn on like the courtesy faucet?
No.
The fan and the faucet, that could kind of cover up. I don't know. That could make some white noise.
Maybe.
No. You're just going to sit.
I'm
okay, got
sit.
It.
So
okay.
I sit and I aim got to the it. Side. You don't hear anything. I'm done. And I can dab with toilet paper. There's no drops on the floor. There's no drops on the seats. It's clean. I've taught my kids to do it. I will not do it in a public restroom. No, I'm standing. I could care less about the guy next to me. Yeah. But if I'm at your house or anybody's house, you know, that I know is clean, I'll sit down on your seat.
It shows you're a thoughtful guy. You're polite.
Yeah, so I'm just being polite.
Okay.
So I thought of this, and I'm just going to give you, you got to give me an answer within 3 seconds, okay?
Oh, geez, the pressure. Okay.
Minivans.
No, can't do it.
Sweet Melissa.
What is Sweet Melissa?
I just want to know what comes to your mind.
Oh, I just thought of Melissa Carter.
I knew it.
Who's my girl?
And I wanted to bring you up, Melissa. I'm like, she's either going to go with Sweet Melissa, some Allman Brothers, or Melissa Carter, who I know has been tight with you through all your years. And Melissa Carter has been on the radio, doesn't really have to work. And I think, is she still on air now?
She is doing financial shows. So a lot like our friends at Impact, but not at Impact. Just doing some financial radio shows.
Okay.
Yeah, and some other things outside of radio.
No, I always saw y'all's two little buds and everything. That was great.
Yeah, yeah.
So I just wanted to see
We've
what
been
you
good
say.
Friends. We started a podcast during the pandemic.
I know. I
and had so much fun with it. Both of us are just in this stage of life as moms that we're just so busy. And it's really, as you know, podcasting is a full-time job. It's
it
really
is.
Hard work. And it takes a lot of time to put it together. So
this
with
kills
her,
me.
Her several, she's got tons of jobs and I have several jobs and we both have kids and schedules and we just decided we were going to push pause on it, but
maybe you revisit that.
Love my Melissa
I like
Carter.
It. Yeah, Melissa Carter. Let's see, best moment in radio.
Best moment in radio? Well, we just talked about one of them, meaning my husband.
Well, that would say that's it. Probably.
Yeah, I would have to go with
or was
that.
It
but
leaving Cumulus.
No.
Steve.
No.
Kidding.
No. Trust me. I mean, there's, you know, there's ups and downs at every
leaving
company.
Leaving the Burt Show.
No.
At the time.
I had a great 10-year run there.
Leaving 101.5.
I left on maternity leave and didn't come back.
By the way, I'm having a baby and never coming.
And I'll see y'all.
Y'all take care now. Oh, wait, how do you say country? Yeah.
And yes. And all right, worst, that's a wrap on that. Okay,
worst moment, best, right?
Best
or best,
moment.
You want to stay with
okay,
best?
Okay, let's stay with
I think
best
it's
moment.
Grant.
Because, aside from meeting my husband, I would say one of the best moments was skydiving on the air.
Yes.
So this was post-divorce. And, you know,
you're
I
like,
just
I'll
like
do
a,
anything.
A lot of like, you know, just a lot of just bad feelings around it. You know, just a lot of like anger, remorse, frustration. You know, you feel like you've got like a, you know, the big letter on your head and all that. And so
a Scarlet D, a tattooed D.
Exactly.
D for divorce, people.
It definitely was just a rough time in life. And I was like, I want to go skydiving. And Bert was like, hey, would you do it on the air? And I'm like, yeah, that'd be awesome.
Put a mic on me.
So we figured it out. And yeah, I jumped with, it was like a Marty remote pack.
Yeah.
And during that time, I jumped with two friends who went with me as well. And what we did was we took a piece of paper the night before and we all had gone out to dinner, had some wine, and we were just talking about what are the things you want to let go of, right? Some of the emotional baggage or the things that are driving you crazy or those thoughts in your head that like just are not the good thoughts, the evil ones that kind of pick away at your self-esteem and your self-worth and all those thoughts. So we're like, let's write them down. And so we wrote down what we want to let go of for ourselves. And then we passed the paper around the table and wrote down what we wanted for our friend to let go of. And
oh, wow.
Told her, you know, so there's three of us. And
Mary,
so
let go of pedicures. Your toenails are going to fall off.
We passed it all around.
Probably more
and
spiritual
then,
than that. But
I don't know. I don't know. This is where I went.
And then we took those pieces
like
of paper and we tore them up into bits and took them up with us and jumped out of an airplane and threw it out.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
So it was this really cool symbolic moment, and it felt really freeing, and it was live on the air, and it was so much fun. And I talked to the skydiving company, you know, in the months to follow, and they said, there's a lot of people coming up here with pieces of paper in their hand, throwing some stuff out into the world.
We're littering.
I was like, sweet! My job as a therapist starts now.
I'm hobbying it. Worst moment.
Worst. Working on the air with someone who was giving me the silent treatment. Behind the scenes,
okay,
for like a solid 3 weeks, wouldn't speak to me unless the mics were on.
Okay.
Have you ever gone through that?
I witnessed it.
Somebody who did the silence violence?
Yeah, I saw
it. That's the worst.
Larry and Eric, it got to the point, it was so contentious between Larry and Eric, whereas most people thought it was me and Larry, but Eric and Larry, Eric would only talk on air. So Eric would leave the room. After, like, we
after
talk.
Every break.
Every break. Okay, we break. Everybody's taking their headsets off. Exit stage right.
Yep.
He's out. He'd stay in the hallway. He would talk to interns or anybody, which would make Larry mad because he's distracting people that he wants to be on the phones or doing stuff. And then he would come in literally 10 seconds before going on air, just enough time to sit down and put on his headset.
Yeah. So there's
and
no,
I witnessed
no
that
planning.
For 6 months.
6 months.
At least
long.
That long.
And 3 weeks felt like 6 months to me because it was brutal. It's brutal. And the worst.
It's the worst.
It's the worst. Because arguing is at least working through it.
Yeah. If you're not working through it, you're not doing anything. And it's just when somebody's shut off. I dealt with that when I was working with Larry Light. That's what I call Bailey. Larry Light. Because he was like, if Larry had a son, it would have been him. And he did the same thing. He was that weird. Like, you know, and I'm like, I just don't have time for this crap. I just don't. It's so hard.
What do you think it is? Like, why do you think that happens?
I think it's people that are narcissistic in this business that also have a huge lack of confidence. And it's that recipe. And it's because they don't want to go out on location or be out in public because, A, they're afraid no one's going to show. B, they're afraid somebody that has a difference of opinion is going to show and want to confront them. And it's
okay.
And it's those two things. And I've seen it twice in my career. And I saw it for 8 years once and 6.5 years the other time. And I will never see it again. I will walk. I will live under a bridge before I deal with that again. But
yeah.
I think that's what you were dealing with. We won't say
it could
who.
Be. No, it could be. It could be the combination of that. Yeah. It's just... You can't do anything with silent treatment.
No, you can't.
You can't really work through stuff. You can't really.
It's not productive.
No.
Yeah. No, it's horrible.
Yeah, so that's the worst, especially when you're trying to do a show and your job is to show up and be entertaining.
Yeah.
How are you entertaining with somebody that won't talk to you?
No, and you try to be entertaining during the days that I was working down the hall from you at Rock 100.5. I owned a bar for 5 years. Never own a bar if you do a morning show. It's stressful because about the time I'm getting up, 3 a.m., 4 a.m. is closing, I'm getting the phone calls from a manager. Hey, a chick broke her ankle. She was saying she's going to sue us.
No.
She weighed 300 pounds. She jumped off the stage in a 6-inch heel and she broke her ankle. She's blaming us. Yeah, and I'm like, okay, there was a fight last night. The police came. Guy got his jaw broken. Okay, great.
That sounds like great show prep, actually.
It is fantastic.
Well, he doesn't show
especially
prep.
For the rock station that you were on.
unless you're
fantastic.
Unless you're writing the check.
Right.
Oh, by the way, we got a call. Somebody didn't pay the water. Water's been cut off. We got to have a check down there in person by noon tomorrow, or they're not going to cut the water back off. And I'm like, and then I come into work and it's like, I'm dealing with that, but I'm going to put that aside. And then I got to deal with this guy that's just a total jerk. And I'm like, you're not going through anything. You don't know. And I just had to deal with it. You know? And I just, you got to put everything in its own little box.
And do you think that people listening knew that that was going on while you were on the air?
No.
Yeah, because I don't know much about
we
that situation.
It. We and hit it completely.
Just listening to you on the air, I would have never guessed that anything was wrong between y'all.
Got to be a professional.
Yeah.
100%. When the mics are on, you got to be a professional. What's your favorite music?
I really like pop music. And I know that's like not a popular answer.
Hey, I say the 80s, I catch a ton of hell, so go for
you
it.
You do? Yeah. Yeah. So I really love, I have always loved pop music. It's really why I got into radio, because when I was a kid growing up, I grew up in St. Petersburg, Florida. And
love
in
it.
Tampa, we had 93.3 FLZ, the Power Pig. Yeah. And old school radio peeps will remember the Power Pig. And there was a nighttime jock there called Bubba the Love Sponge.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know who he is?
Oh, I know, because he came into 96 Rock back when I was there. And he took over 10 to midnight, and he had his little underwear thing. And then he would always, the show came in on Reel to Reel, and Alan Ayo, our night guy, who was on from 7 to midnight, was now on 7 to 10 because Bubba took his last 2 hours.
Yeah.
And Bubba would always, at the end of the tape, going, I'm going to take more hours.
Oh,
I'm going to
no.
take your job. Bubba was just so brutal.
Oh, yeah. He was brash. But he was great to listen to when I was a teenager growing up. And mm-hmm. I loved all that top 40 music. And then, you know, worked in top 40 radio. And I really like upbeat, you know, pop music.
All right. We'll
I
take
know,
that, Jen.
Not a super
all
cool
right.
answer.
No, it's cool. I dig it. You know, I just want to know. But look at the stations. 95.5 The Beat, Star 94, Q100. It all tells a story.
Okay.
This is for me. Years that I disgusted you with my behavior.
Oh, geez.
How many? Just give me
a
total of years.
It's really like a toss-up between you and my buddy Crash Clark, who
I
love.
Come on. Crash was having sex. He's like Mike Key. He and Mike Key have sex with fours and fives. I have sex with seven and a halves to nine.
I don't really remember those years. I mean,
I was coming in on y'all's show and I was doing little things.
Your reputation preceded you. Let's just say that.
Yeah. All right. So there was some disgust.
There were some years where I was like, that's just gross. Like, who's gonna touch that with a 10-foot pole? Because
I'm clean as a whistle.
You're gonna be at the doctor the next day.
Clean as a whistle. Only, just so everybody knows, 1984, gonorrhea. That was it. One hit. I was at Clayton Jr. discharging, and I explained it to the doctor. She goes, "You have the drip, otherwise known as gonorrhea. Shot of penicillin, and
does that get
pills.
Rid of it forever?
Yeah.
I hope
no, just for that okay. moment. I was dehydrated. I was afraid to urinate. It burned. It was like razor blades. I said, never again. But
that
I knew.
Sounds awful.
But by the way, the condom broke on that girl too. So I was trying to do the right thing. Years that you liked me.
Well, I really liked you when I was pregnant because you said that I didn't look pregnant from behind.
What a gentleman. And they say chivalry's dead.
It's not dead.
No, I'm serious, because when you're pregnant, you know, you're just feeling really like swollen and everything just feels, I don't know, you're retaining all this water and... I liked being pregnant, but there's just some days you'd go to work and just be like, you know, I'm just not myself. I just don't feel great. Then here comes Southside down the hallway, and he'd be like, hey, who's that? And I turn around with my big old huge belly. You know?
Once you turn around, you're like, you are pregnant.
And then he was like, you know, you just don't look pregnant from behind. You look great. And I was like, thank you. I needed that boost of confidence today. You know,
years you've loved me.
I've always loved you.
Okay, just checking.
Yeah, I've never disliked you in any way.
No, good.
I have always thought you were very charming. You were always taking care of people. You were always working
always
the sales department.
Yeah.
You know, always work in the room there. And I think, you know, as far as like somebody to look up to in radio, you're somebody who's taken care of clients so well through the years and built those relationships that I think a lot of talent doesn't understand how important that is.
Oh, it's
huge. So I've always taken a page out of your book and try to really take care of the clients who take care of me and build that relationship, because you have the relationship with your audience, right? Mm-hmm. And they're going to trust what you're talking about and what you're telling them to go do, whether that's, you know, any sort of, you know, service or product or whatever it is. And you got to really believe in it in order to share that with your audience, because they trust you and you're not going to be out there, you know, helping sell something that you don't believe in. And so I've always taken a page out of that book. And
Thank you. I
really admire you for that. You've worked really hard in those areas.
I have. And, you know, you also look back at all the promotions and stuff. I was doing like four bar gigs. And those are the ones where you just try to take care of the bar or the brand that you represent, whether it was Miller, Lite, Coors, Bud, whoever, you know. But you're right. My clients mean everything. But then... Also, I think it's our job as radio performers to make sure you represent the best. You know, and you know, otherwise, I don't want right. nobody's ever come up to me and complained about D. Geller and Son or Regal Nissan or any of the people that I've represented because I'm like, look, dude, I represent the best. I'm not going to screw up here.
Yep.
You know, you can and trust what I'm saying.
Yeah, it's teaming up with the right companies right. to do that. Yeah.
And speaking of that, I just want to thank a few sponsors if I could.
Let's do throw it in.
Go to Joe Bees. That's Joe Bees, JoeBees.com for bee pollen. I'm going to tell you right now, Jen, that is why I'm so healthy. You need to put Granule bee pollen in yourself. You get okay. the energy, and it's like a multivitamin. The bee is like the greatest little gift we have, the honeybee, running around taking a little bit of everything. It does so much for the body. So get on bee pollen.
Hold on a second. Do you take it as a pill or a chewable or what? How do
two pills every morning. First thing before I even have coffee or anything, I take two capsules.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's the first thing I do.
Add it to the routine.
And Joe Bees. And right now, special for the Yet Come On show, if you get a year supply, you get 4 months free. 4 months free on a year supply. Just say, yeah, come on to JoeBees.com. Mark, David Markwell. Wow, this guy. I went to marriage counseling with him. He's a counselor for our radio station back in the day for Rock 100.5, and he's really good. He's got two locations. He's got a fine crew, you know, but you can see him and he'll Zoom you or whatever. But there's a lot of people going through stuff, and we know that right now. So DavidMarkwellTherapy.com. That's awesome. Ridgeline Counseling.
I'm 100% behind therapy.
Me too, because I'm going to tell you right now, I've done it twice in my life. If there's something you haven't worked through, why let some bad experience as either a child or a parent or somebody that did something to you ruin your life?
Yep.
Get past it.
Yeah.
Get past it.
Yeah, and they really do help you get through it. They help you work it out, frame it in the right place, and let you be who you want to be.
Right, and that's the thing. You got to be who you want to be. Circle 285, they want you to be insured. You can actually bundle house and car. Go to Circle285, liketheinterstate.com. Legends, Yet Come On Bourbon Whiskey. Jen's drinking it. If Jen drinks it, you should drink it. It's so good, smooth, and smoky. And lastly, we are at Oxygen Financial in the Oxygen Financial Studios with one Jen Hobby. And we've been talking about everything. And, you know, we have basically, I want to finish up with radio because I'm going to move into television because you do both. So in radio, you've been on the different shows. When you left the Burt Show, a lot of people, I mean, probably want to know, was it because you just wanted to get away from the show? Was there an issue, something you've worked through now? Or what happened with the Burt Show?
You know, it came to a 10-year mark, and it felt like a great bookmark to me. I was like, I had done so much mm-hmm. during that time and had such a great experience. I mean, it helped launch my career, and I just learned so much and had the greatest experience. And it was at a time where radio was so king. Everybody was still mm-hmm. listening all the time in their cars, and we were in a big, you know, commuter market here in Atlanta, so people were stuck in their cars and stuck in traffic. And during that drive time, it was at the height mm-hmm. of being in radio was that time. And it was awesome. Awesome experience. But after 10 years, I was like, okay, I'm about to sign another contract, and what am I going to do in year 11 that I haven't already done in year 10?
You've already jumped out of a plane.
Right.
You've met your husband.
All these things, and it was just
this great... You've had a divorce.
Exactly.
I'm going through everything.
Yeah. It was a great crossroads in my life, and I was also pregnant with my first daughter. Mm-hmm. So I was getting ready to be a mom, and I wanted to have healthy pregnancies, and I did not want to get up at 3:30 in the morning Mm-mm. and do the slog it out with those morning hours while I was pregnant. I was like, just at this shift. So it
good
was
for you.
It was truly nothing more than that, where I was like, I want to go out and do my career on my own terms and not on somebody else's show, right? That was a part of the 10-year mark, too, because, you know, in radio, if your name's not on the show, you don't really count as much.
Mm-mm.
And I hate to say that, but for all of you listening, unless, you know, get your name in the title of the show.
You better
okay?
do that. That's why
because
I've always been Southside and something.
You know, with the big powers that be, that's who counts. And so it was like 10 great years, but I thought, you know what? I want to put my name on a show,
mm-hmm.
and I also want to grow and do something different. And if I stay here, I'll just be doing the same thing, which was great, but I just didn't want to keep doing the
same
thing.
It was very brave of you, too, I thought. And that's when you switched over.
It was bumpy. It was definitely bumpy, and I made a bunch of mistakes along the way and made some, you know, some poor choices in navigating all of that. And, you know, if I could go back and do it differently and maybe do it a little bit more smoothly, I would. But yeah, that was kind of what it was. And,
right.
you know, and left on great terms. You know, Bert threw me a goodbye party and gave me jewelry. And so there was no drama
There weren't good terms with any of my breakups. I get to reading the AJC getting trashed by somebody, and I don't ever respond. I'm like, I'm not going to get in a cat fight.
Don't get sucked into it.
I'm going to be classy. I mean, my last
partner. They'll try to pull you right on in. Come on.
He's like, he's dumb. I'm like, okay, I'm dumb. I'll let anybody believes that? I don't care. If you believe that, believe it.
It's like you can't get sucked into that game.
No, I can't. No. So, but it's funny when you read that and that happens. So you've got to be classy. Both of us.
You have to realize that there's going to be a lot of speculation from listeners. There's going to be a lot of talk on social media. Mm-hmm. There's going to be all of that swirling around there. And sometimes you just can't defend yourself.
No, you can't.
And that sucks.
And you can't. You're like,
so hard.
I'm going to let you think what you want to think. And then there's the goodbyes, you know, but the way I got let go from Cumulus, that was just they called my agent and my agent called me and goes, hey, they're flipping to 99X. They're keeping Axel for obvious reasons and they're letting you go. And I'm like, okay. You know, and it was done.
Sat down and talked to you about it.
That never
hurts.
Had anybody
that
talk
hurts.
To me. Never got to go in and get a box of any stuff. I was told, just don't worry about coming back in the building. My general manager, who kept telling me, I want to take you out to dinner. I feel horrible. I've known I had to do this for about a week. I'm like, no. No, you didn't. But that's okay you say this. Just because I know the person and I'm like, you don't have to say those things to me. It's business. I get it. You're looking out after you. You're going to go along with everything. You're not going to fight the fight for me or anybody else. Understood. It's 3 weeks before Christmas and I'm not getting any money. You know, there was nothing.
Do you think it is business
bye-bye.
Or is it personal?
I think it's personal with the person that let me go.
Okay.
And now you're doing a good interview. the person that let me go is the person that makes the decision on content in this region. And I think that they wanted X back for reasons because they used to be a part of it and run it. And they didn't like rock. So what they did is they slowly killed the station. They put on a syndicated show that nobody would listen to, and they know it. They moved me to afternoons, which I'm a morning guy, and left us there with no advertising, but put me with a guy that I love. Put me in a room with Axel. Love Axel. So I had the best year of radio this past year. The best year. What you gave me was my best year of radio.
That's awesome.
And then
that's a blessing right there.
It's a blessing. You gave me a year, you know, in 14 years, and I did the first day of Rock 100.5 to the last. And then I read this nice write-up on Axel, but there was nothing. And I'm like, I brought in more money than anybody. I had more energy. I was the lifeblood of the station. And it's like, there was just nothing nice said. It was just like, Southside Steve, let go. And I'm like, wow, man.
But you almost wish there was more bad stuff said.
Yeah.
Right? You're like,
don't I deserve at least that?
Yeah, at least trash talk me a little bit, right? Yeah. You know,
And I look at my general manager. I go, instead of taking me to dinner, why don't you put three nice paragraphs in the AJC about me? You know, give me a nice, you know, give me what I deserve because of everything I did. But I was like, you know what? Everything happens for a reason. I have a faith system. I'm a spiritual person, and I believe everything will be good. And my wife even said, I think there's bigger things out there for you.
Mm-hmm.
And it's caused me to think of various income streams, and I'm doing things and looking at doing things that I hadn't. I still want radio, and I will always do radio, but I'm going to do these things on the side as well.
What do you think gives you that spirituality, that faith?
I was raised, I'm an Eagle Scout, a Boy Scout, and I was raised Catholic, and I had that faith system. But more than anything, I have crazy confidence, which people always go, how are you able? I mean, I'm a decent looking guy. I've had moments where I look at myself and go, damn, I look great in 2009. I looked at myself. I'm like, I'm at the beach in 2012 with sunglasses on my head. I'm like, I'd do that. But then there's moments where you're like, maybe I'm not all that, you know, but it's confidence. Women or people in general are attracted to confidence. I have total confidence in my abilities.
But
and who
only
I am.
Confidence that's real, not false confidence. Because some people posture to be confident, but that comes off as arrogant when it's not real confidence.
Yeah, so and mine's real.
Somewhere, does it come from your family? Does that come
family,
from
family? Yeah. Friends, family and friends, for sure. My brothers are my best friends. I just grew up knowing what I could do and couldn't do, and I've been put in positions, and I kind of just have I take three steps back and look at myself, and I'm like, you're a good person. I think there's things I could do better in marriage and relationships. To my wife, because I think sometimes it's me, and I've got to make sure that she's getting everything. She's not just Southside Steve's wife. She's Amanda, you know. Yeah. So that's where I need to work on it.
Did you just pull a Taylor Swift?
Yeah.
Did you just go, it's me.
It's me.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm the problem.
I'm it. It's me.
Steve, do you know what song this is?
No, I know of Taylor, no. But I love Jen, and I'll go with anything. I thought she was writing a song. No, it's me?
Yeah, that's a Jen original.
Okay, is that a Jen? I thought maybe.
I just wrote that song.
It's very good.
Yeah. No, it's beautiful. Yeah, by the way, you should give that to Taylor.
Oh, it's like her biggest song. It's like her biggest song. Okay. It's the biggest one right now.
I met her when she was like 14 or 15, and she was skinny then. Now she's put on some weight. She's got some bigger thighs now, I noticed, you know.
It's all muscle.
Is that what it is?
She's just power.
Is it power?
Powerful.
Well, I know
woman.
She's got a powerful ticket. I was like, Lord have mercy, that girl's making more money than any entertainer, I think, right now.
Oh, yeah. Of course she is. Of
she's
course.
Killing it.
Three sold out shows at Mercedes-Benz Stadium.
And with those ticket prices. Like,
with crazy. The craziest ticket price there is.
Yeah. And
I'm sorry I didn't know that song.
And I'm one of the crazy moms who's going. Okay.
Oh, are you?
I was one of those crazy people on Ticketmaster because, you know, in radio, sometimes we have the connection, sometimes we don't. And I was like, I'm not going to hold out for those connections. I am going to just be one of those crazy people on there. And, you know, I almost got divorced over it because when my husband got the credit card bill, he's like,
what?
Have you lost your mind? This is four concert tickets. I'm like, yeah, but we got to go.
So he's going?
Yeah, he's got to go.
No, that's where he stays home.
No,
just buy three.
It's going to be our youngest first concert, and he wants to be there for her first experience. So
I know those ticket prices.
We're tight like that. Yeah.
Yeah, y'all are
Here's
tight.
Here's a good show.
Yeah, you can't hide rich. Okay?
No, you can't.
You can't hide rich.
How do I know Jen's rich? Bought four tickets to Taylor. That's how I know.
Well, she was rich, and then she bought four tickets to Taylor.
And now I'm poor again. Yeah. We're
guess who can't do that? Southside Steve. I will tell you, I make the most there is on unemployment. $365 a month. How's it going? No, it's a week.
Yeah,
it's a week.
Come on.
A week.
He's unemployed, too.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah, come on.
I actually wear it like a badge.
It's a
moment.
It's a season.
It's a season.
It's just a season, and you got to learn all you're going to learn from it.
Yeah, it's been 3 months, but yeah, so I'm not worried. One thing I wanted to ask you, and because this is big, I think with a lot of people, like when people realize I know you, they ask me, they're just curious, what happened with you and Jeff Dollar?
Ooh, I know that's tough. Well, let me just say that we aren't friends anymore. And that bums me out because we were really close friends for a long time. So we met through working together on the Burt Show side by side. And I think he's one of the funniest people I've ever met on the air. I mean, just
really
so funny.
Funnier than me?
I don't know if can you compare funny? I mean, I don't know. I've never been on a show with you, but I'm just saying.
What about the moments I was in your studio when I was doing the dating stuff? I made you laugh.
Yeah, you're funny. You're definitely funny. But I'm just saying.
You're hurting me right
working
now.
Working side by side with Jeff, he was one of the funniest people I'd ever met.
Okay.
And so I'm trying to say something nice. And that is what I'm going with. Okay.
Yeah, Steve, it's not a slight against you.
It's not a slight against you.
Why
I'm trying
you
to say something nice.
Why are you hurting
here,
me on my podcast?
I'm trying to say something kind. And it breaks my heart that we're not friends anymore. And what happened is a little bit trickier to talk about because I still am working at the company that terminated his employment. And so I can't really speak to that because I was a part of closed door meetings and, you know, witnessed things happening that I don't think that I can say publicly while still working for that company. It'll be in my tell-all book someday, maybe, but it's not something that I really feel like is fair.
If you want to write a book together, I've got the title.
Oh, yeah?
I do.
What is it?
I do. And that's one of the things I'm thinking about doing. I was going to do Southside Steve, and then the picture is, and this is why you need to see the show on YouTube. But, you know, if you're driving a car, I understand. And I just look at the front, and I'm like, too tired to laugh. Southside Steve. Too tired.
Too tired to laugh. Oh, those morning hours will kill
this?
You, won't they?
Too tired to laugh.
Oh, that's good.
But we could do Jen and Southside. Too tired to laugh. And you do half a book, and then I don't have to write a whole book.
I was going to say, don't think about writing a book. Just start writing it.
I know.
That's good advice.
The stories will come to you.
They will.
They'll just pour out of you. You've got so many great stories to
tell. I want to tell everything.
So interesting. And then you could pull a lesson out of them, and you could be like a self-help guru.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
I could have a work page. After every chapter, there's a work page. You know,
like a quiz.
Rate your better half, and I'll tell you what matters. And as far as just from a shallow point, like Jen's got great toes. I've already stared at them four times. They're painted. Like they're actually the same shade as your shirt.
Yeah, they are, but only because I just really like this color.
That's a drinking
game. I didn't match my shirt. To
I was about
my
to say because if you wear, you're going to have to wear that color all week. I mean, you might. But no, so Jeff, you can't talk about it. I'm like you.
It's not that I can't. I mean, it's
I don't
not that
talk
I
either,
can't. But I don't, you know, I don't ever want to disparage anybody.
Mm-mm.
I don't ever want anybody's worst moment to be what you know about them. Because I don't think that any one of us are our only worst moment.
No.
Right? I mean,
it's a moment.
There's moments where we are doing our best, and there are moments when we are at our worst, and I got to witness him in both. How about that?
I'll take it. I like it. Do you listen to his podcast?
I never have.
Do you listen to anybody's podcast? Because radio people, I am starting to listen to podcasts too. And I love podcasts. Yeah, we're taking this one a little more serious because we can say things we want. But I'm not a big cusser. I don't need to drop F-bombs because I can. I just don't. I don't see the need.
It's not really my vibe.
Me either.
And I think just being a broadcaster for so long, if I'm in front of a microphone, I don't feel like I can cuss.
No.
It just is one of those like internal brain rules. I don't know.
But if you drink bourbon on Star 94 tomorrow morning, take a sip and say cheers to me, that's fine.
Okay. That sounds good. Yeah, I think I definitely listen to a bunch of podcasts. I'm now a new subscriber to the Yeah, Come On podcast.
Thank you.
Yeah, Come On Show.
We'll take all the subscribers. I'm not charging either. I'm not charging. And this is not better than radio. Else, it's just cool.
Who else locally I've listened to? You know, when Barnes and Leslie were doing their pop culture show, I was a fan of that.
Okay.
I like hearing the two of them together. Leslie Fram's a mentor to me in radio and has been for many time.
I don't think we like each other.
Oh, really?
I don't think we know each other. We've never even been introduced, but I think she doesn't like the things we said about her when I was on the Regular Guys show in the late 90s, early
2000s. Well, if you were a meanie and you were a competition, then...
I was a meanie.
Yeah.
And I was competition.
Okay, so remember that question, what were the years I didn't like you? It was back then. No, I'm just kidding.
Come on, Jen!
I'm just kidding.
Come on!
No, I didn't know that you were mean to her, but I probably would have been real mad at you at that time.
You would have, but it was just...
Because I look up to her a lot.
Yeah, I don't know her, but they were kind of... You know, it was just heavy, heavy competition, and it was like our show was like no other show. It was the Howard Stern of Atlanta, for sure.
Oh, I remember that, yeah.
It was crazy.
The Bird Show was meanies, too, when we were in, like, steep competition with Steve and Vicky and stuff like that. We said stuff about them on the air that I wish we had.
Same thing.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, I said I was sitting behind Vicky in a movie theater, and I couldn't see the screen. I had to say that.
Mean.
That was just mean.
And we've grown up past that.
I don't mean it, Vic.
Not good.
So that was the kind of things we said.
Yeah, yeah. I'm trying to think of other podcasts that I've listened to. I like Cadillac Jacks. I listened to his for a while, okay. He and Donna. And
mornings on the Bear now. The morning show. He just got put in that slot, and he's having Donna do it with him.
Awesome.
So he's on the Bear.
They're great together, and I love hearing their stories about their family. And then I listen to a bunch of national podcasts. I'm kind of like in this realm of listening to all kinds of spiritual stuff. Like I'm going down the Oprah Super Soul Sunday road and
oh my God.
All that kind of stuff. But then I like funny ones too, like Dear Chelsea. Have you listened to Chelsea Handler's podcast?
I like her, but you know what it is? I know too, her politics are so ugly. Some of the things she said, she's so outspoken against, you know, things. And it's when I learn too much about an individual, it causes a problem. I do not know how Bert Kreischer votes or thinks, but I love the guy. Same with Ron White. But I know too much about Chelsea, but I was such a fan of her. She slowly wore me down.
Outspoken is her brand.
I know.
It's who she is. So.
But I like, I've seen her breasts. Everybody has. They're nice.
Yeah.
I loved her show. All the comedians we had them in that were on Chelsea's show, I thought her show was brilliant. Her late night show was brilliant.
Yeah, definitely.
With Chelsea, I thought it was just brilliant. So I like her as an entertainer. You can't really worry. Just like Tiger. I love Tiger Woods playing golf. I want to see him. I love you. But I probably wouldn't, you know, I don't think he's probably a good, or husband. I'll say that.
Sure. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there comes a point where
okay
we got
to
let
things
go. It's
okay to be a fan of somebody for one part of them, but not all of them.
Yeah, and that's it. So with Chelsea, it's good entertainment. I just don't like her as a person, but I like her as an entertainer. I'll say that.
Her stand-up is so good.
I know. She's
I saw
raw.
Her when she came to the Coca-Cola Roxy when it was like the Vaccinated and Horny Tour. Just the name
great.
Of it right there tells you what was the content.
No,
it was so
that's
great.
Awesome.
It was so funny. I mean, stories about her dating, I was like, oh my word.
And she's still, and it's all real. I don't think she makes it up.
I don't think so either. No. I mean, I'm sure it's all enhanced, but it's so good.
Of course it's enhanced. But no, I dig that. Well, that's cool that you're into podcasts. But one thing about you before we finish, and I'm so glad we got a chance to catch up because I love you.
Me too.
Yeah, you're one of the five people in radio, it may not even be five, it might be four, that I truly respect. I know is a great broadcaster and a good person.
Thank you.
And I will say that, hands down. I've always thought that. And then
I'm just going to receive that good vibe now. I'm just going to receive those compliments. Thank you.
And when Jan, and I got to tell you, when Jen's pregnant, you can't tell from behind. It's true. But when she turns around, you're like, oh, shit.
Wow, you are really having a baby.
Those are the qualities.
Are you sure you're not having twins?
I'm like, could be triplets. What happened? But from behind, hot. But then I look at your accomplishments too, and it's the fact you've done different things. You've been true to who you are. You've gone out on your own, which there's protection within a show, but there's, you know, you want to do that. And I've done similar. You know, I like being a part of just a two-person. I don't need the five people in a room thing anymore.
I don't think they're making those shows
anymore. I don't think they can afford them.
No.
But, you know, I look at you. First off, you've won the Gracie Award.
Thank you.
And
it's for women in radio.
Women in radio, yep. Which is awesome. You also are the most sophisticated woman of 2019, so says the state of Georgia.
That was really cool to be a part of a group of women in radio honored at the state capitol. That was fun. It was a cool day.
That was great. And you were kind of like the, I don't know. I mean, I'm trying to think. Dinah Shore of radio or, you know, something like that. You're just that one person that just shines and, you know, whether it's the blonde hair or what have you, Doris Day, I think would be better. But I look at your accomplishments and you're one of those people that look good on TV as well as behind a microphone. So you've got that going for you. And I don't think a lot of people know. So we're going to take a cigarette break, which is about, you know, a quick cigarette where you suck hard. But I want you to shamelessly promote what you're doing right now on TV and radio.
Okay. Right now? Or
mm-hmm. Right now? Right. Just do it right now.
After the cigarette break.
No, no. And that's not a joint.
Well, you're holding it like a joint, Steve.
I know, because I don't know how to smoke. Hold on.
I'm scared and confused.
This is called a cigarette break. That's it.
Don't smoke, kids.
No, don't.
Winners don't do drugs.
No, don't do it.
No. So I host a segment called The Daily 2 on WSB-TV. So it airs after the noon news weekdays and then airs on the weekends. And we highlight different businesses or events or things that are going on around Atlanta. And it is a two-minute interview segment.
I love it.
And with the open and the close, it's actually a minute 50. So I've gotten really good at a quick, short interview, but it's just a way to feature different people across mm-hmm. the metro Atlanta area and a really great chance to work with the very best in television here in Atlanta. That's WSB-TV.
There you go.
Nobody's better. They're number one. And I can now say we are number one and have been for a long time. So
WSB kills it. You grow up in Atlanta. It's all about Channel 2.
And learning from the very best that's there, I'm humbled every time I walk the halls.
Well, that's awesome. The other thing that you've done, too, in this cigarette break, I just want you to talk about, like, I've done HLN about five or six times, and you can see pictures right now of Jen and I on HLN. But yeah, I was really good friends with Susan Hendricks, so I would go on her show for special
Susan
things.
Is so awesome,
love her.
Isn't she?
I wanted to do – she's somebody – there's two people I'd love to do radio with, you or her.
She's so good.
We were talking about it at one point in time, you know, doing something. She just wrote a book herself. But what are your experiences on TV? Why do you think you've been drawn to TV? And the biggest thing of all, if you don't know it, it should have been Regis and you. I'm just saying. It should have been Regis and Jen.
That was a great experience.
Kelly,
so
I'm telling
great.
You, Kelly goes on vacay. Regis says, I'm bringing in five girls from radio, and you co-host with Regis. And I watched that, and I was cheering you like nobody's business.
Thank you. I thought
it was so awesome.
It was so awesome. Such a great experience. And Regis, R.I.P. Regis, was such a true Hollywood gentleman. He had been in that business for so long and just brought this old Hollywood charm to it. So one of his things, nobody ever knew about this. He never talked about it in an interview, but he would go to Kelly's dressing room or Kathy Lee before her. And escort them to the stage every day.
So that's class.
Dress in his suit with his little pocket square and, you know, ready for the show. But he made sure he was ready first, went and escorted them to the stage. So just a gentleman and such a pro that anytime I felt like deer in headlights, because live TV is different.
It is.
Doing live television.
But you've done that on HLN too and CNN. Sure. You got the cameras and people don't realize there's not even people behind them anymore. It's like robot cameras.
Yeah,
they're moving around.
It's just go, go, go. And so there were a couple of moments which you would never even pick up on that I was a little deer in headlights and he just picked it up smooth as could be. And I just loved that experience. It was really awesome.
You like TV over radio or radio over TV or same?
Both for different reasons. So yeah. I like the free form of radio. It's the last really unscripted format. And podcasting, too. I mean, that's why there's been this explosion of podcasting, because everybody has realized, oh, hey, doing a radio show is really cool and fun to mm-hmm. listen to about all kinds of different topics in the world. So I feel like the world is on to us, Steve.
Right. They're I know. I hate it. Let us finish They're our careers, okay? How many years do you need? I need 10.
But what's cool about that is the explosion of audio consumption. Like, people mm-hmm. like listening to people tell stories. It's part of our human nature. It's in our DNA. We learn better from stories than from anything else. And so I love that part of it. And I love that radio, while terrestrial radio is still going strong, it may just morph into another thing. But the skill set that you have will always apply. So just keep doing your podcast. Keep doing your thing.
Keep doing it. Stay sharp.
Television I like for a different reason, because it just makes me use my brain differently. And you have to think about a whole bunch of other things mm-hmm. while you're talking.
Right.
And it's a little bit more polished in the formats that I've done it, and I like that part of it, and I also like that it reaches a whole different audience.
It does.
A different audience is watching TV versus who's listening to your podcast versus who's listening to radio versus who's connecting with you on social media. It's just a new platform, and I really love it.
No, I'm with you, too. No hate in my game, either. I just love that. And now we've come to the point of the show where I have gifts for you.
Gifts?
Yes.
Well, wait a second. We haven't gotten to talk about your kiddos yet. And
okay.
I need to ask about you as a dad, because,
right.
you know, being a mom is like the best thing that has ever happened, aside from marrying my husband, Grant.
Shout out, Grant.
It's the best being
a dark complexion
kiddo. It's the best. So I want to know about your experience with fatherhood, because I feel like that's happened in the last several years that we haven't really seen each other, because I haven't seen you in person since the Super Bowl, if you can believe it, like before COVID.
Oh, my God. Yeah, that's true. I know. I hate that, too.
So.
I want to thank you for being on the show. It meant a lot to me. But with these kids, it has been the greatest gift. Being a father is the best thing that's ever happened to me. I love it. And I've got my two little ones. I've got Brooks and Parker. So Brooks is 5. He'll be 6 May 4th. And I did not name him after a Star Wars character. I know anybody would give their left arm. It's into Star Wars. May the 4th be with you. May 4th.
Oh, okay.
So I didn't call him Anakin or Luke or anything. But Luke was the backup name. But
we went
with Brooks,
because
it's a family name. My grandfather, my mother's side, was Clifford Brooks, and his mother's maiden name was Brooks, and that's where that came from.
And
he carries my name as his middle name, so he's Brooks Stephen. And then little Parker, we weren't sure, and I don't know about you, but you've got the one kid, and you love everything, and you've got this incredible love for this one child, and you're like, I'm bringing another one in.
How am I going to do this?
Is it going to hurt the love? Am I going to love one of them more than the other? And it just works out perfect.
Your heart just grows.
It grows.
And all of a sudden you're like, wait a second. I didn't know I could feel this way about two little humans.
And I do. And then I've got Parker, which Amanda picked that name. And then he's got my middle name, James. So it's Parker James and Brooke Steven.
So cute.
And Parker is 2. He'll be 3 June 18th. And he is just... Like this morning, he brings this little work thing out, and he's got these little tools he likes to clean up. He's my cleaner-upper. He's the one that wants to help mommy do everything. He goes, no, and he talks in third person. No, Parker help you, mama. Parker help. And he goes in and he makes everything in the kitchen. He makes the drink we drink in the morning, the little blended with, you know, she's throwing bananas and grapes and pineapple, whatever she's doing. He does it all. And he has to cook every meal with her. And he's got a little stand that we pull up. And he goes, no, Parker help. He has to help me take out the trash. And when it's time to clean up, it's like, Parker clean. And he walks around and cleans up.
Horrible.
And he's so effing cute.
Okay, so how has being a dad changed you?
It's made me definitely a little more on the safety side. Like, my wife's like, get rid of the Harley, get rid of the dirt bike. You don't need the sports car anymore, you know. And I was pretty crazy. There's nothing I wouldn't do. I mean, I rode my Harley all through Buckhead and Atlanta. I lived downtown, so I was ripping between cars and everything. But then now I'm like, ooh, I got to be there.
Yeah.
I got to be here.
Yeah.
So even I've become a little more safety-oriented, but it's made me worry so much about them. And it's made me much – I always was a caring person, but I kind of hide that side of me unless I'm really in the know. I just keep it all – I like to make other people feel good. You know, that's what I do. And now I just can't hide the love. I got to have the kisses. I got to hold them. And it's just something that I love and think about every second of the day. You know, and I'm scared as much as I'm happy. They're right here across at the school from us. You know, my wife picked them up right when we started the podcast. And I just worry. I worry. This morning, Parker just didn't want to put on his pants. I'm like, is he telling me something? Is he telling me he shouldn't go to school? Something going to happen at school? Because, you know, all the crazy crap in this world.
Yep.
And I start worrying about that.
Yep.
And,
I do, too.
And I just
worry. It has been harder lately to send my kids off to school.
And that's bothering me.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I know we got, you know, we're very well protected and shut down. So I would say the thing that's changed me the most is the ultimate love, but the ultimate worry. I've never worried like that.
Yeah.
And now I even worry about my wife.
Into a different fear.
It does.
Because you love them all so much.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want anything to happen to them.
No. And I pray every night. I pray for them. And I'm like, God, if you got to take one of us, you take me.
Right.
Don't you dare. You know, I just, that's, so it's turned me a little bright light off of me. I know I finished fourth now, and that's okay. We don't have a pet, I'd be fifth. We would.
That's
anything.
Good news, though.
If it
that's
was a
growth.
Turtle, a damn
fish. Did you
hear fish.
That? That's growth. That's growth. This
yeah,
man has
I've
been
come
to
a long
therapy.
Way.
We've learned a lot today. He's been to therapy.
It has. It has.
Loves his wife and his kids.
I do. And she dresses them the same, even though they're, you know, 3 years apart. But she buys, for a while, it's just so cute. They're in the same shirt and same pants and like little twins, even though they're not.
So cute.
But I love it. Same shoes, socks.
That won't last for long. Enjoy that while it lasts. Because they'll eventually be like, Dad, I'm not wearing the same as my little brother.
Yeah, exactly.
Brooks is going to be like, that's not cool anymore, Dad.
You do great boy voices. I'll try your girl. Hi, Mom. Is that creepy? And one thing about us, and I love this about you, because I look at myself in pictures and everything, and we both have squinty eyes.
Oh, my gosh. Yes, I do.
I have it too.
I can't control it. I try, and when I smile, they totally disappear.
Me too. Every
totally.
Time I smile, I'm like, where are my eyes?
I know.
Then I notice it in interviews and stuff.
I can help you with the lashes. I mean, do you want to try some false lashes and see how that does?
Steve, I think you got to go with Jen on
what
this
do you think?
One. Yeah,
what
yeah.
Think? I mean, that could be a whole other podcast, a whole tutorial on your YouTube channel.
We do a makeup tutorial with Steve.
Okay.
Come on. Here, that'd be good, ready. Right?
Yeah,
good
I would do it. I would do anything. Here's
good
what
content.
I'm,
just for the troll comments, we
why
should
not?
Do it.
Oh, yeah. People like, oh, I get my man card. My cousin's like, I'm cutting a corner on your man card because I get my hair highlighted. I'm like, dude, guys, don't go to barbers. Go to hair salons. The girls are beautiful and they can do better things with your hair. Than
if you
barber.
Have long hair like you, I would definitely do a salon. I mean, if you're just shaving it off,
then it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
But Evan,
Evan's got great hair.
Oh, thank you.
Evan, you should go to a hair salon. And I say Balance Salon because that's where I go, and I've been going there because CJ, I met CJ of Balance because of you guys on The Bird Show, and I have gone to her ever since.
I remember CJ.
She did all y'all's makeup and everything because y'all would go
She's
on
awesome.
Camera a lot. I mean, there was makeup being done. In radio, you never see hair and makeup, but you saw it with The Bird Show with Jen Hobby. But yeah, it was fantastic. But I believe everybody should try to look 10 years younger, maybe 15 at the max. It's when you get the facelift and try to go back 30, you look weird. You know, don't go that far. But I believe in Botox. I believe in things under the eyes. I believe in highlighting, you know, 20 push-ups at least a day if you're not having sex.
20?
I do more than that.
Really?
100.
Every day?
Mm-hmm.
You do 100
push-ups a day? This is a routine or a ritual for you?
It's a routine to something I do. I drop to the floor because I'm not in the gym like I used to be. Mm. I went from 244 to about, I'm 204 now. So I've lost weight in the pandemic just because, you know, I wasn't going to the gym or doing anything. And my wife runs, so I'll run with her. And then she cooks. She's a gourmet chef. So she cooks, you know, very well. And she's like, that's not good for you. That's not good for you. Because she's a dietitian by trade.
Awesome.
So, yeah, I live with somebody that knows what not to eat.
So she's got you healthier.
Yeah. I still sneak a donut in there or something. I'm not telling her everything. I buy Intermans. I think it's called Intermans. I don't know how to pronounce it.
That
damn donut on the back aisle. It's a really high rich.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
I hide it. She doesn't know. They're hidden.
Where do you get rid of the trash?
I just throw it. Well, there's no.
Do you go to the gas station near your house and just like pitch it there instead of driving home? And
he gets a motel room to just eat donuts and throw them out.
That's where all my lotto cards go. but no, I keep telling people 5% of my portfolio is gambling with the Georgia Lottery. Why I've never endorsed them, I don't know. I think I can still win. I can do it.
You can.
I can do it. You can't win if you don't play.
That's true.
So I'm trying.
Isn't that the tagline?
I don't know if it's not. If it's not, I said it first. You heard it here first. So I've got these shirts. My wife says, Jen is not going to wear those shirts, Steve. I think you might. But
what
I made these for women. I've got. It says, these are my sayings that I made up.
I love it. Okay, your trademarks?
If loving me is wrong, be wrong. Yeah, come on.
That's adorable.
And I've got them in. I've got a medium.
Steve,
small,
show the camera, please.
Okay, show the camera.
Yeah. Two cameras.
Come on, we're on the Home Shopping Network
so
here.
That's so cute.
Yeah,
I love these. This T-shirt quality. Oh. It's like the soft, like worn in, like you've already washed it a few times.
PTS promotions. Yes. I only get the best for yetcomeon.com. Go to yetcomeon.com and order
today.
This
is so cute.
But I've got...
And it's the right color.
It is.
It matches your toes.
Thank you. So do you want a medium, a large, or a small?
Is this a medium?
That is, I think. Look.
I like medium because then it goes long enough.
And then I've got my running.
I'm long-waisted. Sometimes smalls make it like a crop top. And
you don't want to do that?
I already said I'm 40-something. We don't need to have a crop top anymore.
We ain't doing that no more.
We passed the crop top stage,
but
okay?
But you didn't know. But then I've got my runner shirt that I did for women. I drew the palm tree.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, I love that. That's then a great little beach cover-up.
And then on the back, you get a little, come on.
That's adorable.
So, are you medium?
Yes.
All right.
And I'm getting both swags?
Yeah, both swags.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
You're unemployed, Steve. We should sell these.
I was going to give you one and make you buy the others, but I love it. We should sell these. You get a Yeah Come On hat.
A trucker hat.
That
I
could
love
be for
it.
You or your. That's a beach lid or something like that. And then you got two koozies. Okay. Here's your two koozies.
Dude.
Got your Yeah Come On koozies.
You are totally hooking me up here. Thank you so much.
And then the best of all, do you have a pair of car keys or anything up here? See anybody car keys?
I do.
Because I'm going to give you... Oh, hold on. I may have mine.
More stuff? Yeah, I had no idea. Right. I was just coming to hang out and catch up with my friend. I didn't know I was going to get all this swag.
Well, I guess get a goodie bag.
Friends give friends things.
Good bourbon. Mm-hmm. This is really smooth.
You love it?
Typically, with bourbons, I'll like have a sip and be like, that's enough. But I have actually continued to sip on
this. Listen to this.
Okay.
Every time you...
Yeah, come on.
It's my voice. Every time you open a bottle.
I love it. That is fantastic. I'm going to give this to Grant for his
Grant, this is for you.
Awesome.
And lastly.
One more thing.
This is so sweet. Thank you.
Here it is.
You cannot keep giving me stuff.
Here's your bottle of Yeah, Come On bourbon.
Stop it.
And now you're good. Merry Christmas.
Thank you. This is like Christmas.
It is. I just want to thank her for coming on. Those of you that listen to this podcast or watch it, how much I appreciate you and appreciate this individual. This is Jen Hobby of Star 94. And Jen Hobby, again, what do we call the show? The Twos on WSB?
The Daily Two on WSB TV.
Those are the things she's doing now. We've talked about everything she has done. And now you know Jen Hobby a little bit better. Atlanta's finest radio broadcasters. Southside and Jen. Actually, it should be Jen and Southside. Girls always go first.
You know what? Just ride this out. You never know. Crazier things have happened.
It has. This is show 164 of the Yeah Come On show. Can I get a Yeah Come On?
Yeah Come On. How'd I do on that?
You did good.
Was it a good Yeah
Come On? I liked it. It was like you can go Yeah Come On or go Yeah Come On. You can do a quickie. Yeah Come On.
Or Yeah Come On. That's a little too southern.
You're trying. Now you hurt the brand.
Okay. I like my first one better. Let's go with that. Okay?
Yeah, come on.
Great. Yeah, great.
Only the first one.
I'm keeping all that.
No.
No.
Only the first one.
This is the first one.